nightfall, the churches were crowded with bewildered people who had heard the news of humiliating defeat. This was Pearl Harbor, America's prime naval base in the Hawaiian Islands. 19 proud ships rested on the bottom. 4,572 men were dead, wounded, or missing. In the hands of Japan rested the balance of power in the Pacific, bought at a known cost of 48 planes shot down, 3 midget submarines, perhaps 150 men. It was, on the surface, the cheapest bargain in history. But thanks to Japanese treachery and deceit, Americans were aroused to the depths of their souls. They now stood shoulder to shoulder, of one mind, of one purpose, with the peoples of all free nations everywhere. Through crowded streets, America's great war leader, the late President Roosevelt, drove to the Capitol.
With confidence in our armed forces, with the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph, so help us God.
Yes, America said, as the nation's youth put aside the ways of peace and turned to war, we would gain the inevitable triumph. But how? With what?
Against all their enemies whomsoever, and that I will obey the orders of the President.
Part of the answer would have to come from these. 50 million men and women, trained and untrained, skilled and unskilled. The answer lay here. As a result of lend-lease, American industry was already partly on a war footing. But ahead lay giant tasks: reconversion, re-engineering, retooling. But the greatest part of the answer, as always, would have to come from the men who would meet the enemy face to face. Boys from the forests of the Northwest, the mines and factories of the East, the farms of the Midwest, the cotton fields and canebrakes of the South. Could these millions, trained only in the ways of peace, be taught to handle rifle and grenade, airplane and warship? Could they be welded into a fighting force able to master the veteran warriors of Germany and Japan? Time was of the essence. Time to draw blueprints. Time to lay keels, to retool factories. Time to train men. The demand was astronomical, far beyond the capacity of the factories, still inadequately equipped, the workers still inadequately trained. On every front, in Europe, Africa, in Asia, the United Nations fought with their backs to the wall. And in the Pacific, time was doubly the enemy.